Welcome to the second part of Part 6 in your Physical Geography online course. This unit is specifically number 17, which deals with fluvial environments or river environments. So some of the content that's going to be covered within this chapter deals specifically with, first, being the evolution of a river system, going from young, mature, and old age. It will then also bring in the ideas of those levels of maturity and the features found within. That being said, we'll learn a little bit about discharge. Discharge is the volume of water that moves past a particular point at a given time. So as an example, we could say that the discharge of a particular river is 50 cubic feet per second, and we measure these volumes. Since we're kind of talking about water at that moment, we can also talk about how material is moved. As mentioned previously, we'll begin to mention erosion, transportation, and deposition, the golden three that we'll kind of continue with throughout the end of the semester. We'll talk how water has the ability to erode, transport material, and then deposit. So we'll see where these things kind of move along in this course. We'll also discuss that within water, when material is moved, it can either be moved as a dissolved load, meaning that all of the minerals and material is dissolved completely in the water. To kind of give it a more tangible example, it would be like a powder mix that you mix within your bottled water. When the powder is completely dissolved inside, we call it dissolved load. We know it's there, but we can't pull it out. It's not tangible because it's been dissolved. Or the second way that material can move in a river is known as suspended load. Those are kind of like the floaties on the top of that mixture. So the floaty stuff that's within, we can actually grab it and pull it out. And the last way that material moves through water is going to be through bed load, which is usually the clasts or the chunky things that are just too big and they sink to the bottom. Moving forward throughout this idea of rivers, we can look at how velocities change the material that's moved. The greater the velocity, the greater the energy, the larger the material that can be moved. We'll then move, lastly, looking at the way that we analyze river systems. We'll look at them as a way that we put them in an order. We look at a drainage basin, which there's many different types of styles that this chapter will kind of go throughout, discussing perhaps a dendritic style, which is more like a root system where you have a canyon and all the smaller tributaries, the smaller bits of a stream, merge into one main channel, looking kind of like a root system. Or maybe it's parallel or rectangular or even a trellis style. So we look at these larger areas of land, how the river systems create a pattern, and then we'll measure the discharge and how it moves. Moving forward within that, we'll talk about some of the features that are developed, such as alluvial fans, deltas, point bars, cut banks, different types of meandering streams and braiding streams. We'll also be able to put them in order by counting all the meanders and all the different types of tributaries or reaches and giving that system or that drainage basin a number. The larger the number, the more potential it has for water to be moved or transported. This book will also give us some examples of actual locations, places that you can observe, but perhaps you've been to places that you've seen a river system. What we learned to kind of take this back to the beginning of this video, you know, when looking at the different maturity that a river system can have. A young river system is usually very straight, usually found within a mountain, a higher slope, so the water shoots in a straight line. So imagine like tilting a table up and pouring some water on it. It's very steep, the water shoots in a straight line, goes all the way down very quickly. Well, that would be an excellent example of a young river system. Those type of systems, because of its steep gradient, you'll find waterfalls, you'll also find rapids, and you'll also find a lot of material that's being moved. As that material continues to be processed, the slope, because the material here is being washed away, will slowly become, you know, more decreased. When it becomes about half as much, we consider that a mature system. The river is now able to kind of wiggle a little bit. It's not such a straight line. Then we kind of progress the last part, which is going to be what we consider old age, where it's very, very flat, places like Louisiana or Mississippi, where the rivers are very broad, not very deep, carry a lot of mud and material, but don't have a tremendous amount of energy, and they have these very long and rich meandering systems. So we'll be able to do that. What's also interesting, might I add, is that through that progression of young, mature, and old age, it's not age appropriate. We don't actually give it a time and say, well, if this river is X amount of years old, it must look like that. That's not the case. It's based off of its development. So that can also make it very challenging because it's not uncommon for river systems to then rejuvenate or refresh because of perhaps an uplift or an earthquake. what I would like for you to imagine is when we talk about river environments, if you've ever had the pleasure, opportunity, or privilege to experience the Grand Canyon. The Grand Canyon is an excellent example of a river environment, as you have active incision of the water within the Colorado River cutting down through the Colorado Plateau, removing that material to the point that it's become so deep that the walls on either side can no longer support their weight. And then they crumble within them, and then move that material farther down and dump it out into Baja. So think of, you know, when I think of rivers, when I think of these environments, I try to think of things that I've seen or things that I've experienced, because I think it's a lot easier to do that versus looking at a book or a random video, is to go, okay, well, I've been to this river. What type of features does it have? What environment would it be classified under, and what does it look like? And that really helps kind of put things together. So again, this particular chapter deals a lot with features, again, erosional, transportation, and depositional, the golden three. We'll talk about the evolution of a river system, the rejuvenation of a river system. We'll talk about the material that is moved, and that's pretty much it. That's kind of the big content within this. Also, make sure that you take note of the different types of drainage basins. Again, you'll discuss many of them that are in the book: rectangular, dendritic, parallel, deranged is another one. All of those designs represent, you know, the visual interpretation of a landscape. You know, looking at, okay, we have all these smaller tributaries, which are smaller creeks and streams that join the major river. They join. You know, when I think of the word tributary, I think of the word contribute, because tributaries contribute to a bigger channel. So no matter where you live, you maybe have seen those smaller creeks that drain into a bigger river channel. Where I live, we've got the Santa Clara River that goes from the high desert all the way out into the Pacific. Well, all these smaller streams go into the Santa Clara. The Santa Clara is dry most of the year, but when we do get rain, it does actually hold a really prestigious amount of water. Well, nonetheless, I hope you enjoy this chapter, and we'll talk soon.